And our next speaker will be Brady Medig from Washington University, St. Louis, telling us about the Roman view of strong gravitational lenses.
Right. Thank you. So I'll be talking about an image simulation pipeline that we've been working on to generate realistic images of strong gravitational lenses to be taken by Roman. So we're interested in static galaxy-galaxy strong gravitational lenses. I'll call them strong lenses for short. It's a rare phenomenon where you have two galaxies that are lined up nearly perfectly along our line of sight, and light from the distant galaxy is being gravitationally lensed around the closer galaxy. And in cases of excellent alignment, we get these beautiful Einstein rings. And they're rare because the alignment needs to be very good to get these characteristic arcs of light, which makes these strong lenses as opposed to, say, weak or micro lensing. And they're very pretty. It also turns out that they're very useful. So, as we heard yesterday, there are two main applications in cosmology of these objects. First, there's inferring the Hubble parameter H0 from looking at multiple images of time-varying sources, measuring that time delay, so-called time delay cosmography. There's also the problem that I'm interested in, which is inferring properties of dark matter substructure. So, this is the subgalactic scale structure in the dark matter halos of galaxies. N-body cosmological simulations of various theories of dark matter suggest that there should be these subgalactic scale structure, these clumps of dark matter called substructure or subhalos. And we're interested in these subhalos because these different theories make different predictions about the properties of these subhalos. For example, simulations of warm dark matter suggest that there will be many fewer subhalos below a certain mass cutoff compared to, say, cold dark matter. And this nice figure here makes it clear that if the deflector isn't smooth, if it has all of these clumps in it, then there should be some signature in the image that you actually observe. It turns out that this signature is quite small. We're talking deflection angles of milliarcseconds. So that's what makes this work challenging. It also means a couple of things if we're going to be successful in detecting these subhalos. First, we're going to need good statistics, so lots of samples. We're also going to need high angular resolution. That's one of the most important properties of a telescope for doing this kind of science. And also, we're going to need to understand the effect of the detector on our images, which for Roman, a big one is going to be the variation of the PSF across the focal plane. So, because these objects are rare and dim, there are only about 1,500 known systems today, where many of these have been picked up really in the past couple of years by convolutional neural nets, which are sifting through tons of data from ground-based wide area surveys. So most of the substructure work has actually been done with Hubble images from the Sloan's Lens ECS set or the SLAC set, and there are just over 100 SLAC lenses. But even among those, only a handful are high enough signal-to-noise or sufficiently well-aligned to be able to do this kind of science. So there are a handful of example papers here, which are just taking a handful of systems and trying to do science with that. But we really don't have enough of these systems, so we haven't yet been able to put any serious constraints on alternative theories of dark matter. But now is a very exciting time for strong lens science, with Euclid going up last year, conducting the wide survey, with LSST expected to come online soon. We're predicting orders of magnitude increase in the number of known systems. But as far as characterization goes, there are a number of reasons that make Roman a very compelling instrument to do the actual substructure characterization. Preliminary survey simulations of the High Latitude Wide Area Survey predict tens of thousands of strong lenses. And a fun fact is that since Roman's field of view is so wide, we actually predict, even with as rare as strong lenses are, that there will be at least one strong lens that is high enough quality that it will be amenable to substructure characterization in every single exposure of the high latitude wide area survey. So that means that for Roman, the entire imaging component of the high latitude wide area survey will be doing new, exciting strong lens science. So some of those papers that I showed on the previous slide were using things like machine learning and forward modeling to try to detect massive subhalos or to statistically infer properties from a large set of simulated images about subhalo populations. And to prepare for doing this with Roman data, we've been building an image simulation pipeline called Mejiro, named for this cute little bird, Mejiro in Japanese, which has this distinctive Einstein ring-shaped mark around its eye. And Mejiro is a survey simulation fed into an image simulation. So we start out by simulating the high latitude wide area survey. We do this with a survey simulation package that the LSST strong lensing team is working on, SLSIM. It's been extended to Roman, and it draws a realistic population of galaxies across cosmic time, allows us to decide which one of those are going to form pairs that are detectable strong lenses in the high latitude wide area survey. Then it gives us the parameters to model those systems. So the mass and light models are analytic. The parameters we're getting from empirical distributions. Then the next step for dark matter subhalos, we're using a package called PyHalo, which integrates nicely with the next step of our pipeline, the ray shooting part. And it allows us to generate realistic populations of CDM subhalos. It's quite a powerful tool. It also allows us to generate, say, warm dark matter, self-interacting dark matter subhalos. So if we want to see Roman images of those alternative theories, it amounts to changing a couple lines of code. And then we go into the ray shooting to determine what the surface brightness arrays are going to look like without PSF convolution or detector effects. Finally, we use web PSF to generate PSFs across the focal plane. And then we apply Roman WFI detector effects with Gaussen's Roman module, and that gives us single exposures. So these are just some summary statistics of the detectable strong lenses. We're finding over 40 detectable strong lenses per square degree, so that comes out to 68,000 in the complete high latitude wide area survey, compared to the 100 or so that we've been working with for the past decade. And not only compared to Hubble are we getting orders of magnitude more samples, but we're also probing a wider population. And then, as I mentioned, we're using Gaussen's Roman module to apply detector effects. We want these simulations to be as realistic as possible. If, for instance, we hand these to a neural net, we want the neural net to understand the behavior of the detector insofar as it can do that, just to give it the best chance. And we're taking the latest values from the WFI technical documentation to model each of these effects in the appropriate order. Now, one of our main questions for studying strong lenses with Roman is the effect of the variation of the PSF across its massive focal plane. What is this going to have? What is the effect going to be on substructure inference? Now, this hasn't been as much of an issue with Hubble due to the detector size and because we've been able to point Hubble at these systems individually. But with many of Roman strong lenses, we won't be able to choose where on the detector the particular strong lens happens to be. So the question is, what effect will the variation of the PSF have on our ability to recover that subhalo signal? And will we need to account for it when solving the inverse problem? So we have been given measurements of Zernike coefficients at 5 field positions on each of the 18 SCAs. So what I'm doing here is just cubic interpolation between them to color in this figure, just to give us an overall sense of optical aberration across the focal plane. And as you can see, if we generate a PSF over here and then compare it to PSFs across the focal plane, with respect to the ones relatively nearby, they're not too terribly different, but as we stretch across the focal plane, we start to see some distortions. And these distortions are non-trivial. So this has precisely the effect that you would expect on actual images of strong lenses. So say you were to image a system here in this bottom corner, where the wavefront errors appear to be minimized. Should the same system appear at different points on the detector, again, due to this field dependence of the PSF, you're going to get ever so slightly different images, and this smearing effect becomes more significant the further away you go. And our preliminary work suggests that, yes, this effect matters for substructure detection. So we're looking at the radially averaged power spectra of these images, and the increase in power that you get at small angular scales due to, say, the presence of more low-mass subhalos is at a scale that is comparable to this smearing effect. So we're arguing that a substructure inference pipeline should take into consideration both the SCA and the position on the SCA that a particular lens was detected, and then somehow use that information to back out the substructure signal. So here are some of the highest signal-to-noise strong lenses. From our pipeline, we're getting color from F106, F129, F184, which are three or four of the bands that are expected to be utilized in the high latitude wide area survey. We're looking to, well, first quantify using radially averaged power spectra. We also want to increase the realism by considering real sources from the Cosmos field instead of Sursich profiles. We're looking to explicitly model line of sight halos. Right now, we're accounting for the aggregate effect of distant massive line of sight subhalos with a couple additional parameters in our mass model, but we can explicitly model those with PiHalo. And we also want to consider the variation of the PSF across a given image. These postage stamps that we're looking at here are 10 arc seconds on a side. And the entire scene is being convolved with the PSF at the center. But we can also ask about the variation of the PSF within the scene. Maybe not an issue for these lenses with Einstein radii below 2.5 arc seconds, but certainly for cluster scale lensing, where we're talking arc minute scale, Einstein radii is something that we'll need to worry about. And then we want to generate a large training set if this is going to be fed into neural networks. And we're very excited about Space Telescope's Roman iSIM to do even more accurate image simulation. So the code is available on GitHub. We're hoping to have the paper on the archive very soon. And thank you for your attention.
Okay. So we have any questions? Yes.
Thanks, Chris. This is really exciting work. So if I'm understanding right, you said 68,000 strong lenses versus the 100 we've been working with. Are all of the 68,000 going to be suitable for the substructure work?
Unfortunately not. That number is just detectable. To do substructure inference, we'd like signal to noise above 25. What I was considering detectable earlier was signal to noise about 10. And on that histogram that sort of falls off logarithmically. So there are going to be fewer that will be really amenable to substructured characterization, but it's still going to be thousands.
Okay. And how are you doing the PSF characterization? Like, is there any way to do it empirically once we get the Roman data, like to use stars at different points in the field to back out the PSF and measure the Zernike coefficients from it?
This time, I'm not sure that's for whoever's building that inference pipeline from the simulation side. It's just web PSF and we plug that in. But as far as how they're going to back that out and how they're going to implement that, there could be many ways, I hope.
Yeah, I think there are efforts related to that, both at the SOC and at the High Latitude Imaging Survey Pit. So we should talk about that.
Thank you for the talk. And have you explored the probability to detect the double Einstein rings in the Roman surveys?
That is not something that we have looked at yet, but certainly these more exotic lensing configurations are of great scientific interest. So certainly something to look at, but not yet at this time.
Okay.
See one more.
Yeah, thanks for an interesting talk. Is this all you're mainly focusing on just imaging studying the imaging, or is there any GRISM component that you've considered at this point?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that last bit again?
Is there any GRISM component or spectra component that you've considered?
Not at this time, no. And probably not as a part of this particular effort. This is really focused on imaging.
Okay, well, let's thank Bryce again.